All right, everybody. Hello, how are you?
We can hear you.
You can hear me now. I am so sorry about that. Let's start over again. And again, thank you for sitting back and watching, saying, well, I can see his lips moving, but I can't understand what he's saying. Now that you can hear and see me, it's much better, I'm sure. So to each and every one of you, I apologize for my faux pas. You would think that I do this for a living. And I do. I'm Kelly Wright. It's a pleasure to be a part of each and every one of you today. I'm Kelly Wright, the host of The World Tonight, which premieres tonight on the Black News Channel nationwide, 5 to 7 p.m. So join us tonight. We do a lot of stories on the Black News Channel that focus on you in particular, as well as the faith community. So as I stated, I'm very happy to be here with you today, and welcome to the National Black Church Initiative's second National Clinical Trial Lecture Tour series. And I will be introducing our guests in just a moment, but first, let's get things started off the right way. Let me introduce you to you, Reverend Anthony Evans, and he will have words of welcome and a very short prayer for each of us.
Very good. Again, thank you, Kelly. You're always such a pro at this. And thank you so much, our guest, Dr. Lisa Cooper, and certainly thank Janssen Pharmaceutical for their support for this lecture series. This is the second National Clinical Lecture Series that we have hosted, and we're excited about this because we have had our guest before, and she was so wonderful, we had to invite her back. So I'm very happy to receive her back. And let me also apologize from the top that our co-host, Dr. James McCoy, had a medical emergency with one of his patients, and he cannot be with us, but he wished us well, and we certainly wish him well as he deal with that situation. So this is fantastic opportunity for us to discuss a topic that need to be discussed, and is why health disparities should be important to everyone. And that's a critical topic in a post-COVID era, as well as dealing with it now. And also I like to make sure I acknowledge Ms. Cassandra Smith, my boss. So it's good to see you again, who is going to have a wonderful conversation with our guest, the renowned Dr. Lisa Cooper. Everybody knows her across the world. People has been calling about the book, when the book will be ready. So we're excited about that, and we'll hear more about that as well. So let us have a brief, very, very brief word of prayer. Also want to acknowledge Dr. Joseph Webster, who has granted us a few minutes of his presence. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, who's chairman of NACI COVID-19 Data and Information Committee. And you'll hear more from that this week, next week, about that. So thank you so much, Dr. Webster, for your leadership and your technical support in that committee and the important work that we do. Okay, so let us pray just very briefly. Thank you, O God, for all that you have given during these difficult times. We thank you for our country. We thank you for our president. We thank you for the Congress. We thank you for the pharmaceutical companies that you have utilized as part of your healing methodology to the whole world. So we thank you for J&J, Johnson & Johnson. We thank you for Moderna. We thank you for Pfizer and providing the vaccine for all of our children. Thank you, O Lord, for all that you do. We pray for each and every one on this call and everyone in this country that they may receive the vaccine in which is given. We also pray, O Lord, for everyone's home, that everyone will be safe. Their loved ones, their wives, their husbands, their brothers, their sisters, their children, everyone. And we ask this in the name of the God of your own faith, that he may look over us, bless us, and keep us, so that we will celebrate again your name in our churches soon. Amen.
Amen. Reverend Anthony Evans of the National Black Church Initiative. We thank you for the word of welcome, as well as the wonderful word of prayer for not only our organization here today, but the entire nation and the entire world. I would like to now introduce you to our distinguished colleagues who will present this wonderful talk that we're having today. Let me provide some housekeeping just at the top so that each and every one of us know where we're going. There will be questions and answers from the audience after the talk. So in the meantime, please mute your mic. And most importantly, our distinguished guest, Dr. Lisa Cooper, you heard Reverend Evans mention her and mention her book. She has a forthcoming book entitled, Why Are Health Disparities Everyone's Problem? I love the question that she's posed. And NBCI, by the way, will give 10 free copies of Dr. Lisa Cooper's new book, Why Are Health Disparities Everyone's Problem? To the first 10 attendees Bronx, New York, and our church community there. If you arrive early, please put your name in the chat room so we can make sure that we notify you and you are one of the first attendees to receive the book. We also have a treat for you at the end of the lecture. I will render one of my, maybe it's a treat, but one of my songs from my album, Love Train, will be provided as well to talk about where we are as a nation and how we have to move forward. It's a song that's gospel-tinged and faith-based and focuses on where we are. So I hope you take time out to listen to it and watch that as well. So as I stated earlier, I am truly honored to be here today. It's really a wonderful program that NBCI is presenting. And so let me introduce two distinguished individuals with us for our lecture today, Dr. Lisa Cooper and Ms. Cassandra Smith from Janssen Pharmaceuticals. I'll introduce them individually before we get the discussion started. So let me first introduce Dr. Lisa Cooper. Of course, she is from Johns Hopkins University. She is an expert on the COVID-19 disease and the statistical data surrounding hospitalizations of African Americans and people of color. As she is presently serving as the James F. Fries or Professor of Medicine and Bloomberg Distinguished Professor of Equity in Health and Healthcare at Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine, School of Nursing, and Bloomberg School of Public Health. The title of her lecture is Why Are Health Disparities Everyone's Problem? And again, if everyone could just mute their mics again. She also has a forthcoming book with the same title as we've mentioned before. And then we have Cassandra Smith currently serving as the Director of Diversity and Inclusion in Clinical Trials at Janssen Research and Development LLC. That's part of the pharmaceutical companies of Johnson & Johnson. We've heard a lot of talk about them with regard to the vaccine. And also I'd like to say in this role, she leads the strategy to advance Janssen's diversity and inclusion for the clinical trial strategy. The strategy aims to increase diverse representation of clinical trials by increasing access to, awareness about, and trust in clinical trials in underrepresented and underserved communities. Extremely important. Prior to this role, Cassandra was Associate Director, Patient Engagement Strategies with Janssen R&D. And in this position, Cassandra led efforts to optimize the informed consent experience for clinical study participants, including co-creating the informed consent document with patients and scaling electronic informed consent for broader use with Janssen R&D studies, research and development. Cassandra holds a BS in general science biology from the Pennsylvania State University and an MBA in healthcare and pharmaceutical marketing from St. Joseph's University. So to our guests, we welcome you. And to our panelists, we hope that we will be enlightened and have our information and our wisdom broadened by your insights. Let me begin with Dr. Cooper with a question that I have to you as part of the panel. First of all, congratulations on the great work in your book of Why Are Health Disparities Everyone's Problem, especially in the post-COVID-19 period. And if I can, again, to those who are watching and listening, please mute your mic. Let's give you a chance to do that. Mute your microphone so that we don't hear extemporaneous noises All right, that's good. Now, I understand, Dr. Cooper, that you are an expert in hospitalizations. In addition to that, I want to share that, I'll be very personal with you. My wife had COVID-19. I had COVID-19. We had mild cases of it. And let me tell you, mild cases are nothing to play with. And we still have some long haulers aspects of that with brain fog. Hopefully my brain fog will not enter today. But I wanted to share that with you from a personal standpoint, that I'm not just on the outside looking in. I've been on the inside, and I'm now working my way out of it. So can you speak to the relationship between health disparities and the number of hospitalizations from COVID-19?
Certainly, I can do that. And first, I just want to say thank you to the National Black Church Initiative for inviting me to be with you today. And, you know, thank you, Mr. Wright, for introducing us and kicking us off. And I'm sorry to hear about your personal experiences with COVID-19. But sadly, it's not unlike a lot of other African-Americans and other people of color in this country who have been disproportionately impacted by this condition. I think we've heard about it a lot through the media, but our hospitalization rates have been much higher, in many cases, almost two times as high as whites, and our death rates from COVID-19 have been much higher in communities of color, with American Indians and Latinos and Pacific Islanders having much higher death rates, as well as African Americans and whites throughout this entire time. So needless to say, our communities have endured unjust treatment by institutions, including healthcare and research, for generations, but the COVID-19 pandemic has definitely shown a magnifying lens on those disparities in our life experiences and in our health.
You know, and in dealing with those disparities, the disparities abound, and getting the information out like you're doing now, working at Johns Hopkins, what have you seen in terms of breaking down the disparities and crossing that threshold of getting African-Americans and Native Americans and Brown Americans to understand how important it is to have vaccinations?
So, you know, at the outset of the pandemic, I think one of the things that hampered us was that we didn't actually have a lot of good data on this. And so we did a lot of work, scientists and clinicians and public health people, to engage with policymakers and people who actually collect data to really advocate for us getting better data on how this disease was affecting our communities. So once we were able to do that and to really show that we had this disproportionate burden of illness, we were able to then advocate more effectively for better access to testing and also to treatment. So now, you know, one of the things that we're focusing on a lot is partnering with communities, working with trusted members of our community, such as our faith leaders and leaders of other organizations, small businesses, anyone who is trusted in communities of color, to get the word out about the safety and the effectiveness of the vaccines, so that people will be more accepting of it, because we know that there's been a long-standing history of, because of unjust treatment in our society, that people are understandably skeptical and may have some levels of mistrust in, you know, this, you know, vaccine that was developed so quickly. I have to say, though, that it's really encouraging that we've seen over the past several months that mistrust has actually gone down, and that the rates of African Americans saying that they would accept a vaccine if it were available to them has gone up to about 70%. So about 70% of African Americans are willing to take this vaccine now. And so now we need to also work on making sure that they have access to it.
Yes, the availability is so important. Let me bring in Ms. Cassandra Smith right now. Ms. Smith, can you give us a sense of how Janssen is approaching this complex problem of these health disparities to which Dr. Cooper has just spoken, that everyone talks about as well, but no one seems to have a handle on it? And can you give us the key issues surrounding the problem?
Sure. So thank you so much, Mr. Wright, for moderating this session today. And I really want to thank the NBCI and Reverend Evans for having us in partnership to bring this programming to the community. It's really important that we get out and really talk. And I'm honored to share the virtual stage anyway with you, Dr. Cooper. So thank you. So really, really, really great question. And I think what we're seeing as a result of COVID, but not, or maybe I shouldn't say as a result of COVID, but maybe spotlighted in a way that, you know, only COVID could and only the events of last year could, is a focus on talking about health disparities. It's a household word just as much as clinical trials is now, you know, essentially a household word as the world waited for a vaccine for COVID-19. So I think it's a great time now that we're having this discussion that we're really focusing efforts. I can tell you what Johnson & Johnson is doing around health disparities. So back in November last year, the company launched an initiative called Race to Health Equity, and it's a commitment of $100 million to really make sure that we are looking at health disparities and doing our part as one of the largest healthcare companies in the world to solve some of the disparities that exist. For my specific and my team's specific area, that disparity is in the clinical research and clinical trial setting, where there are known disparities. There is a lack of participation by, you know, underserved, underrepresented groups, minority groups. And I'm taking a very US lens to this, although we are a global company and we do serve other areas that, you know, I think we've been a little bit better in, but we've not done some of the work we could do in the US to make sure that Black and Brown communities participate in our trials. So that's one example. Specifically in the clinical trial setting, we have a program called Race to Health Equity, but Research Includes Me. And that program is meant to start to open the dialogue with communities about clinical research, what it is, what it isn't, how they can get involved, where they can find out more information. So we were happy to and proud to launch that last year, and we'll continue that.
You know, that's quite a program, because what happens with something like that is that you find that the communities that we're most concerned about, these communities of color, you're actively, proactively, I should say, getting engaged with them to pull them into those clinical trials and for doctors and pulling them into the clinical research, which is so important, and having everyone there represented in the room, so to speak, so they can tell the story from a Black perspective, a Brown perspective, a Native American perspective, which from my vantage point of looking at it as a journalist, but just as an African-American man, I want to see someone like me who's involved and knows the disparities that come along with my community, whether it's environmental or health related. So, as you continue to do that program, Ms. Smith, how do you see that going, and how do you see it dissipating and mitigating the virus as well as other disparities?
Yeah, so it's a great question. I think Dr. Cooper touched on something that's critically important. Trusted messengers are critically important to this conversation. You know, I work for Big Pharma, Big Bad Pharma, right? The community doesn't always want to hear from us. Granted, we have obviously a very large stake in the conversation and, you know, helping to end the disparities. But I too, you know, taking my corporate role aside, and I'm, you know, a person, a patient, I do feel comfortable talking to somebody that I trust to give me information and tell me this is okay for you, this is right for you, or this is something you should consider. So I think what Dr. Cooper said with engaging the community through trusted partners is absolutely critical. And that's how we're going to get to a better space. But I also want to just point out too, that in the past, industry in general hasn't really had this level of community conversation that I think we are having now. And I think, you know, as Dr. Cooper said, people, not that it's, you know, exclusively for this reason, but with conversation, with education, with a dialogue, an open and honest dialogue, people are willing, absolutely willing. They are not, you know, shut down to the idea of participating in trials. And so these community conversations must continue. I see them continuing as like a norm and a standard, really. So that has to continue.
Yeah, communication can certainly close the gap. Dr. Cooper, let me bring you back in, please. Do you believe that we can turn the corner on our past from the most notable aspect of our past, where the federal government and the medical community really created an egregious and outrageous program on Black Americans, and that was the Tuskegee syphilis experiment. Do you think we can turn from that? It, many people today weren't even born back then. And can that change now? Can we get beyond the past to realize that today the ethical standards are greater and higher, and we can hold the medical community as well as Big Pharma, we can hold their feet to the fire to do the right thing?
Absolutely, I do believe that. And if I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be able to continue doing what I do. But I would say, for sure, I think we're able to do that. And I think we've taken a lot of steps in that direction. We still have a long way to go. Cassandra Smith mentioned, many organizations have not paid enough attention to this for a long time. And so it's really taken the commitment of leadership and, you know, a lot of people working on these issues for a long time to raise consciousness and awareness about it. I like to think about the approaches as falling into two broad categories, one of them being relationships. And that's the area of trying to make sure that people actually communicate well with each other, have respect for one another, that they really know a lot about each other. So people who are doing the research or delivering the healthcare actually understand the communities they're serving and that they're working with, know the history of those communities what has happened there. And also are aware of their own biases and their own history and how that could be influencing their relationships with those individuals and those communities, that they actually engage people in open and honest dialogue, that they're transparent about what it is they're doing, that they are respectful about people's right to make their own decisions, and that they look for some kind of common ground. And so that's what I call the relationship portion of this work. And then the other part is more structural, and it's more about the actual resources and practices and policies that are put in place. You know, is there a clear mission to be inclusive and to be respectful of communities on the part of the organization or the healthcare system? Is that organization doing concrete things? Are they building partnerships with other community organizations? Are they transparent about their practices, why they do the things they do, and why they don't do certain things that you know people might be expecting them to do? Do they devote funding and resources to this work? And then finally, are they diverse and inclusive in their own staff and their own leadership and their own governance? So I think, you know, when organizations can really develop some best practices in those two areas, that's when we can really see a shift and some improvement happening in this work.
Yeah, and Kelly, if I can.
I'm happy to say that I've been involved myself in being a bridge between academia and community through the Center for Health Equity that I lead.
Yeah. Very good. Kelly, if I can, I think that what Dr. Cooper just said is just amazing, because if you look at what Dr. Cooper has done over the years and the importance of her book at right now, it serves as a bridge from the academic and the intellectual to the community. They are working with the National Black Church Initiative, who has an extraordinary outreach that we are doing now. And this really important is that Johnson & Johnson, of all the pharmaceutical companies, they the ones who need to be applauded, because they are standing up and providing the resources necessary to create a permanent bridge in dealing with the issue of clinical trial consent, conformed consent, which Cassandra is an expert in. So you really have a perfect example of what Dr. Cooper just says that can take place. And I like Cassandra just to run with that, because I think it's very, very important that you point out what we are doing now as an example of what can be done now and in the future. Cassandra?
Sure. No, and thank you for that. I was actually going to ask Mr. Wright if I could 2 seconds just kind of build on that, because I, you know, Reverend Evans, one of the things you said that I think is critically important is this longstanding bridge of information from academia, from trusted sources. That's correct. And if we didn't learn anything from COVID, it's that we must have correct and trustworthy information for people to get to a better, you know, better understanding. So I am extremely proud to be working with, you know, have our organization, the Janssen, Johnson & Johnson organization, work with MBCI on a program. Is it okay, Reverend Evans, if I say the name? Okay, the Clinical Trial Education and Awareness Program, which is meant to be almost like a self-guided curricula for members within the NBCI community to learn more about clinical research, basic information, not anything study-specific or disease area-specific. The goal is in time to build upon that as people get more comfortable with clinical research, people, you know, normalize participation, get their questions answered, just come to a better understanding. We certainly want to provide resources for people to get involved. But right now, what is critical is that we provide just kind of general information without asking, will you participate? It's more, will you at least understand what it is clinical research is and isn't, so that, you know, we can discontinue the disparity that really exists right now within clinical research. And just to give you some numbers, so clinical research by African Americans in particular is very low. It depends on the disease area, of course, but just generally, only about 5% of clinical research, 5% of participants in clinical research are Black Americans. That's really low when you consider some of the diseases that affect us that we're over-indexed for. So we really do need to get in and start to participate better so that we can prove the science and make sure that the, you know, drugs that are being rolled out work and therapies being rolled out work for everyone. So really proud to partner with NBCI on this, you know, kind of resident program.
I commend all of you for being involved in this kind of forward-thinking, proactive approach to get more Black Americans involved in these clinical trials and even clinical research. From that vantage point, I think it's always good to encourage the young African-American students who are going into the medical field to consider careers in research and development of these programs so that they can be in the room like Dr. Kazmekia Corbett with the development of a vaccine over at NIH, but and like Janssen is doing as well. Look, we are a year removed now from the start of this pandemic, and it seems to have taken this pandemic to pull the veil off of our eyes to see the disparities. I recall on my previous show, actually a year ago, stating that this was going to hit the Black community hard, very hard, along with some experts who had come on to talk about the disparities and what we were up against. And also given the fact that we were pretty much the large part of the essential workers, and then we have multi-generational families and things of that nature. We were up against a hard time, and now, more than 500,000 people who are gone because of this COVID-19 pandemic. It's very important now that these vaccines are getting out, 3 of them out now, to have the availability. Both of you have talked about that. And Dr. Cooper, you were alluding to how do we get this into the Black community? And I want to ask you, how do we get it? What's the best way of doing it? Because we have so much within our communities and so many services, particularly the church, that can get these vaccines into the arms of African Americans.
Right. I mean, I think it's a complex issue, but really, if we look at the approach that's being taken right now for vaccine distribution, what we're doing is using age as the primary eligibility criterion. So we're saying people who are above a certain age are going to be eligible to get the vaccine because we know that those age groups that are at highest risk. Now, I'm not saying that that's incorrect, but we do know that because of the other reasons you mentioned, the fact that people of color were overrepresented among frontline workers and lived in multi-generational homes and so many of those things and lacked access to ways to protect themselves from the virus, like such as not actually being able to stock up on food for weeks and weeks at a time, we had a number of people who were much younger in communities of color who contracted COVID and became ill. And so we've had death rates among younger individuals, and we've had much more family spread of this infection. And so it really makes the case for the fact that we shouldn't only be using age as a criterion for who's eligible for the vaccine, but we should really be looking at which communities have been hardest hit by COVID and really making sure that vaccines get distributed to those areas preferentially. And that also when we get into those communities, that we ought to be vaccinating entire families. We shouldn't be restricting it based on age, because in communities of color, it wasn't only age that drove our death rates, okay? It was a lot of our other risk factors within our social environments due to all these historical factors that put us in these communities where we didn't have the resources and the investments that, you know, other more advantaged communities have. So we really should be looking at working with state level officials, public health officials, policymakers to make sure that we're thinking beyond just straightforward things like age and making sure we are looking at the most hardest hit communities to make sure that they have access and that we're not just offering the vaccine in health centers or convention centers or so on and so forth, but we're opening it up to places where people can get to, like churches, for example, like community health centers. We're providing transportation so that people can get there. We're making sure that we're working with employers so they give people time off work so that they can go and get vaccinated. So it needs to be a much broader kind of strategy, because people in communities of color don't have the same advantages. They don't have that flexibility. We need to make the sign-up process much easier, not something that is only driven by having a computer and being able to navigate a website. So let people be able to sign up using the phone or using walk-in systems. So there are lots of different things we need to do, but basically go to where the virus is. You know, one of my colleagues, Kirsten Bivens Domingo, is at University of California, San Francisco. And she wrote a piece basically saying, we need to go to where the virus is. Take the vaccine to where the virus is.
Absolutely, touch the world where their need is, and that means going there. Now, Ms. Smith, I wanna bring you in, Cassandra, because you represent Janssen, J&J, and the President of the United States as recently as Thursday, when he gave his first address to the nation, talked about how he was proud to see that J&J and the other companies were working together. Here are pharmaceutical giants working together because, as he stated, they understand, or your organization understands, that we have to be on a war footing, that we are at war with an insidious virus and its variants. And in order to win this war, your team, the American team, has to come together in order to make sure that we give shots of hope into the arms of everyone. Having said that, he went on to talk about the marginalized communities, getting it out there. I know from my reporting and my interview with Dr. Anthony Fauci, I asked him specifically, do you get this into the Black community by going through Black churches and historically Black colleges and universities? To which he said, absolutely, we have to do that. Is there a mechanism in place with the National Black Church Initiative and other Black church organizations and even HBCUs to start implementing that plan post-haste?
So I think it's a really great question. And again, I think it goes back to trusted parties and trusted community members that can actually, you know, tell the community it's okay. There is a really large and expansive vaccine rollout, vaccine, you know, education program that J&J has, that Janssen has, now that, you know, we have emergency use authorization in place. I would say a big part of that is education, is going to trusted community partners, as we've been talking about. And I think what's so great about that is the rollout is complex, but the solution is rather simple. Get it in front of the community with people they trust. It's really, really simple. So while my team is not responsible or involved in the vaccine rollout, we're very narrowly focused on bringing the, you know, vaccines and bringing the clinical trials to the communities, there is a very large expansive program. And I know we've talked with Reverend Evans about connecting the team that's overseeing the vaccine hesitancy and education with NBCI. I don't know that we're at a final place, but certainly I would say churches are absolutely a place that we should be going. Other community, you know, institutions, if you will, healthcare centers. There's a lot of talks with some of your larger healthcare centers that serve, you know, underrepresented minority communities as well, and minority communities as well. So there's a really broad rollout that's underway. I can't go into too many specifics because, again, it's not quite my team. We've seen the plans and it's massive. I can say that.
Yeah, and I'm just looking at our, thank you for that. I'm looking at to see if we have any questions coming in. I do want to open this up to those of you who are watching to share your questions and comments. I'm looking in the chat room right now. I see some applause going on for the things that both of you have stated. I do want to point out—
If I can bring folks up to date on where we are.
Okay.
As you well know, the National Black Church Initiative has offered a comprehensive COVID-19 plan to vaccinate 106 million Americans, both Blacks and Latinos. We've been working very, very closely with the National Hispanic Medical Association, who emphasizes, as Dr. Cooper said, is on families, testing the whole families. We have taken that message to the White House, to every single governor in the country. They have the plan, their chief of staff, the chief medical officer of the state, as well as the governor. So we have a forthcoming conversation with the Governor's Association in terms of implementing that plan through faith-based communities. Right now, we are focusing on several churches, and one of those churches in Houston, who's connecting with the medical center and the state to offer vaccine in 19 locations in Houston itself. So it's getting out, it's rolling out very slowly, but it's happening. And certainly we will continue to talk internally with our new partner, Janssen and J&J, as to what role they want us to play.
Okay, very good. And let me also add to that, that you were talking about Houston, Texas. The president of Texas Southern University, which is an HBCU, has been very involved in that community as well. And then over in Durham, North Carolina, Pastor Jay Augustine of St. Joseph's AME there in Durham is working with the HBCU North Carolina Central University, and they are actually distributing the vaccine, and they've been in the heart of the community. So those are other assets to NBCI, as well as Janssen, as well as Johns Hopkins. Let me ask both of you a question. Ms. Smith and Dr. Cooper, where you sit, and well, not sit because you're actively engaged in all of this, where do you see the future? Because we have a president now who is has his game face on, his war footing on, unlike the previous administration. It's not that I'm going to get into the politics, but politics in some kind of way may have marred the rollout of this vaccine and may have increased the hesitancy among some. Do you think that this new administration moving forward with this $1.9 trillion stimulus package and this COVID-19 aggressive approach to getting vaccines out there by May, making it available to every American, and then by the end of May, with the hope that we can get through this dark tunnel and have some light, ensuring that people are vaccinated? What do you say about that program?
Well, I'm very encouraged by it. I think that it's, you know, the public health system has been very under-supported for a long time. And so this influx of funding is going to be very helpful to build up the infrastructure. We really need, you know, to train people who will be able to go out there and deliver some of this education and do some of this vaccination in communities. So people like community health workers working in partnership with nurses and pharmacists to do this work. I think that this funding is critically important setting up sort of a tracking system so that everyone knows like who is being vaccinated and where the settings are that people can go and get these resources. So I think that's going to be really important. I think a lot of the other provisions of the bill also indirectly enhance health equity because, you know, for example, we know that people of color have been hit by unemployment at much higher rates. And so, you know, everything that extends the unemployment benefits and that provides additional income and that provides funding for childcare, it's going to really allow people to be able to get back to work and to be able to afford to stay in their homes, to prevent evictions, to be able to afford food. There's extension to some of the food benefits. All of these things are going to be very helpful along with, you know, the other sort of, you know, expanding access to health insurance, you know, for people who don't have employer-based health insurance, as well as, you know, funding for the public health sector. So I think this is incredibly encouraging and it goes even beyond just COVID. I think it's actually addressing some of the other longstanding issues as well. Now, hopefully, you know, once this funding initial period is over, some of these provisions will be able to be like put in place for a longer period of time.
Well, real quickly, before I go to Cassandra, what you just unpacked is really going to help a lot of people mentally, because there's been a lot of mental stress and duress and anxiety and angst and heartbreak because of this COVID-19. And I think if you can get into the psyche of the American people and in those communities that have been hard pressed because of things like suicide ideation, all from this COVID pandemic, if their attitudes are stronger and better, then it's that they'll probably join you and roll up their sleeves to say, how can I help beyond getting the shot in the arm?
I think you're right. And I think one of the things that actually is emphasized in this funding is an emphasis on shoring up the behavioral health system. And we know that this is going to be critical at this time for everyone, but particularly for our children and our youth of color who have really gone through a very, very difficult time, having lost many more relatives, having lost parents, and having to witness this, you know, awakening by the country to the violence that many of us have experienced for decades, you know, perpetuated towards us by the police. So, you know, I think that there's going to be the need for a very strong focus on mental health and on holistic healing approaches during this time. And I think this funding couldn't possibly come at a better time, a more needed time.
Yeah. Cassandra, I want to bring you in now. You know, you were talking earlier about Big Pharma and the way that some people look at Big Pharma. Yet when I speak to you, Cassandra Smith, I see someone who looks like me with a beautiful poster on the wall saying life is beautiful. So let's break down the mystique of Big Pharma, because Big Pharma is made of big families. Big families like your family and my family and Dr. Cooper's family and Reverend Evans' family. Let's face it, we are all in this together, getting back to what the president has stated. So even Big Pharma has a role to play, because they too are not exempt from having COVID-19 disrupt their lives.
Exactly. And I think what you just said summarizes this all. This is a human conversation that we're having. This is a people conversation that we're having. So it's not about where you sit, what job you have. It's not about that. It's how do we as a community move forward? Each of us using our expertise, our position, our connections, et cetera, to make that happen. And so pharma absolutely has a space, you know, a role in this space, 100%. I mean, we bring therapies and products to market that should work for all populations. But yet, you know, the stat that I gave a little bit earlier about the disparity that exists within clinical research, that has to change. And we can't say that it's the community's job, or it's the physician's job, or it's the church's job, or it's whoever, right? But pointing the finger at some other being to make sure that we're providing a level of comfort and information and education to the community. So I honestly see And I think that's evidenced by the Race to Health Equity Initiative that I mentioned earlier in the talk that J&J has to commit, you know, this money, this funding across 5 years to really look at health disparities and health equity or inequity across the board, not just in the clinical trial setting. We're, you know, a major pharmaceutical company. So across the board, and really put their money where their mouth is. For us, again, narrowly focused in the clinical trial setting, it is absolutely our responsibility to make sure that we are providing basic information and education for people in conjunction, in partnerships with people like Dr. Cooper, with Reverend Evans, with other parties that have a connection to the community. So we really believe that. I think race health equity is, you know, kind of evidencing our commitment there. And then some of the work that we're doing with research includes me again, a phased approach to make sure that we're providing a structure and a support to work with the community to raise up information, not to say, here's a trial, join it. At this stage, we're just not ready for that kind of conversation yet. So it comes down to, again, the people and really just connecting with people and making sure they're ready.
Reverend Evans, let me bring you in on this because I love that race to health equity. But we need a race to equity on all fronts that would help Dr. Cooper, that would help Ms. Smith, that would help pharmaceuticals, that would help the medical community, that would help the Black community. So the education and the information and the motivation and encouragement could come from the pulpits of the Black church. Is that right?
Yeah, not could, but are. We are doing it now. As you well know, one of the things that I should have said, that there are over 30,000 churches right now that is offering the vaccine. The problem is we can't get our hands on it. If we get our hands on it, we will be able to do it exactly like Dr. Cooper has indicated and the National Hispanic Medical Association. We will do the families. We will do the families who's affected, the big families. We will do all the communities. We would do the homeless, the blind, the disabled, the bedridden, pretty much everybody. And that's what our plan called for. So we are actually putting our total resources. And I must tell you very frankly, the church is not, of course, the church is not taking in a dime these days because we are not meeting. So, I mean, our income is down, but our service is way up past 900% in the community. We understand that we cannot survive as a church community sitting on the sidelines, in which the Black church is not. I'm very, very proud to say that all of our denominational leaders, all 37, they are committed to moving forward. And not only that, Kelly, they are really committed to what Janssen is doing. I must tell you, and you'll see that comes alive very, very early. One of the smallest things that we are going to do is not only support Dr. Cooper's book and make sure that key members of our congregation have that book, we are going to make that book available. That is the type of stuff we need to do in terms of education and outreach. We're going to have all of this information in one area so that people can access it very easily. So we are working hard.
Well, very good. Again, I want to make sure that we make this statement to everyone who's watching. If you have any questions or comments, please feel free to deliver it via our chat. I'll see it and we'll bring it up. We'd love to hear from you. I want to get to Dr. Cooper again. Your book, why did you write it?
Well, let me tell you, I wrote it for a number of different reasons, but I would say the main reason I wrote it is because I've seen so many people not think of health disparities at all because they don't have to deal with it in their daily lives, or people who live in communities impacted by health disparities feel sort of, you know, powerless over it. And so I really wanted to raise awareness, not among all those people. I wanted people to be able to see why this problem matters to them, no matter who they are, and that they actually have a role to play in solving it. So for people who come from communities that have been impacted by health disparities for generations, to really be able to have that knowledge and understanding of what the problem is, and to know like what the strengths are and the resources are that are within their own communities and their own families and within themselves, where there are things that they can do actively to really advocate for themselves and to keep themselves healthy. But then on the other side of the coin, for those people who haven't experienced it, to really see that these problems that may appear to be across town or somewhere else and not really part of their life problem, to see how allowing people to suffer who are part of our society and to not have access to the opportunities that you have to be healthy can affect your own health too. So I think Cassandra sort of alluded to this, but the fact that, you know, we're kind of all in this situation together, even though some of us are in, you know, different situations, but, you know, we've all been stuck at home. Our economy has been shut down. Our children haven't been able to go to school. Our hospitals have been over flooded, so we can't get appointments. All of these things have affected everyone. And it's all because we didn't protect people who needed extra protection at this time. And so this disease is like a primary example of how health disparities are everyone's problem. And so I really wanted people to be able to see that interconnectedness and to see what role we each have to play in solving this problem. And I wanted to get that word out. And little did I know that was before this even happened, but this pandemic actually made it critically important, I felt, to get the message out.
Yeah, it was very prescient to get that out before it even hit. And it shows how interconnected and interrelated we are. Ms. Smith, I'm reminded of a part of the gospel where it says the least of these. And I think far too long, we have overlooked at the least of these. And now we see through this pandemic that the least of these is actually all of us if we don't do right by our neighbor and take care of each other.
We're dependent on each other, you know? Yes. We need people to deliver groceries. We need people to ring us up at the drugstore. We need people to pick up our trash. We need people to take care of our ailing relatives and our older relatives. And, you know, we call people essential workers. Well, we really need to treat them that like they are essential and that they're valued. And so I think this has really shown us how important each person is to making our society a better place. But we can't just expect it all to work if we don't do our part.
Cassandra?
No, I agree absolutely with all of that. This very much so, this is, you know, again, it's a humankind issue that we must, you know, solve. And I know that sounds a little, you know, spacey, but it's true. It really is. In order for us to move the needle and to really have the impact that we want on our world community, we must all work together. And like I was saying before, you know, we think about this conversation that we're having here. We've talked a lot about making sure that we have trusted partners. Those trusted partners come in every facet, walk, even color, creed, you know, across the board. And so we have to look at that same person that we're relying on as like a trusted voice, trusted partner in a community might be the person that we haven't really taken care of. So we have to lose titles, lose egos, and really just look at this from, we are all in this together. I wholeheartedly echo what Dr. Cooper said.
I love how you just said that, you know, lose titles, lose egos, because at the end of the day, and actually with the COVID-19 from the beginning to the middle of the day, to the end of the day, this has been no respecter of persons, titles, places, or things, or your wealth status. It's hit everybody very hard. I had one other question before we begin to wrap this up. You know, the president wants to take care of Americans first, rightly so. But the vaccines that are available, he has stated that once we get through taking care of our home front, then it is something that we have to do in sharing it with the world. You know, this is a global problem. So to that end, you know, it's almost, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's almost like being on a 747 or a plane and you're flying to a destination. And when they go through the safety presentation, they always ask you that in the event of a possible, some possible trouble in the plane and the oxygen mask come down, they actually say, put your oxygen mask on first before you turn to the others to help them. It's kind of the way I look at what the president is stating about sharing the vaccine with the rest of the world. Let's make sure we're together first so that we can then proactively help others. Is he right in that?
I think he is definitely right. And I actually think we should be thinking about sharing this vaccine sooner rather than later. You know, it's true that we have our own problems here, but I think we even saw this with the Ebola epidemic. So we are a global community, and we actually, the COVID pandemic showed us that we are a global community, and we have inequities that are global. So yes, we have these inequities within our own society, but you know, we are a very wealthy country, and we have been fortunate enough to be able to purchase these doses of vaccines. And the one thing that's hampering us now, a couple of things are hampering us, but one of them is around getting the supply up and going. And then the next is actually the logistics of the distribution. But we have the money to buy these vaccines. There are a lot of other countries that don't have that. And yeah. If we don't share that and those people become ill, it's only a matter of time before it comes back and it starts to spread around the world again. So we really should be thinking about this issue of why health disparities are everyone's problem. It's not only domestically, it's actually a global problem. And so, you know, as a wealthy country with so many resources, we do have to take care of ourselves, and we have to provide some leadership and work with others around the globe around how we address this issue. Because, you know, as we've seen, when we turn inward and or try to like close off our borders, it just doesn't work. You know, this world is connected. Our climate, we all are experiencing the climate changes. We all are experiencing so many of the changes in biodiversity, the changes that have contributed to this virus. So I think that's something we should really keep high on the agenda.
Very good. I want to get to a question that came in from one of our viewers. And the question is, how do we keep focus towards screening diversity in clinical trials with all of the attention to vaccine hesitancy on our community? We kind of went over that, but that's a more specific question from that individual. So can both of you answer that?
I can maybe, if I could start, just give a first pass. Like, I think that, and I know we're nearing time, what COVID specifically has done is made clinical research a household word. So pre-COVID, I don't think that, you know, you would be sitting across at the dinner table and have on the news or be, you know, talking as a family and hear this notion of clinical research, you know, .. you know, but being potentially the end to the pandemic. Now we have that as a platform. We have many other disease areas that we also have to focus on from a diverse, you know, perspective and raise up the participation. Oncology as a, you know, area, therapeutic area, is something that a lot of companies are really focusing on. It makes up, you know, the bulk of our portfolio as well. And so there are a lot of diseases within oncology, just using this as an example, that also need to have greater diversity within the clinical trials, multiple myeloma, prostate cancer, et cetera. Those are diseases where there is a disproportionate impact, prevalence, morbidity, outcomes, et cetera. We have to have diversity there as well. So what I'm hoping is that as a result of COVID, as a result of, you know, this constant conversation about clinical research being out there, and people now at least have some understanding or familiarity with the notion or the concept of clinical research, that we can really take this moment, really seize this moment to continue to build upon the information and education that's out there within communities. So it doesn't die on the vine. It was there before, but this has absolutely given us a spotlight we didn't have before.
Yeah, and you know, Dr. Cooper, every crisis can become an opportunity. What say you about this?
So, you know, I'll say this. I say that the inclusion and engagement in clinical research is just one manifestation of a much broader problem that we have in our society. And it's just, how do people of color really see themselves as being engaged in this society? And I think that's the issue we really need to work on. the issue of, you know, the fact that people have been sort of marginalized for so long. And what we need to do is to make sure that people feel motivated to be engaged, that they actually see a role for themselves in society, and that it's a part of something they need to do, but it's really something that institutions and organizations need to really work on, you know, making sure that they give to those communities, do what the pact is. A society is supposed to protect its all of its, you know, residents. If we do what we are supposed to do, I think people in communities of color will rise to the occasion and participate and engage as they should. But that's really where we should focus. And I realize that that's a much broader topic that we could have a whole nother conversation on. But I think the involvement in research is just one example of that.
Well, we will do that. I'm sure Reverend Evans is working on that for the third installment of these wonderful talks that we're having that have been so insightful, so informative. I want to thank you both, and I'll bring in Reverend Evans to close things out. But Dr. Cooper, congrats again on the great work and your book of Why Are Health Disparities Everyone's Problem? Great work in terms of what you're doing at Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. And Ms. Cassandra Smith, good to see you. And life is beautiful, like you said, and that other sign behind you there says stay humble. I like that. With all the great work you're doing at Janssen and J&J and all the great work that's going on in terms of this pharmaceutical giant reaching out to help stop the health disparities so that we can get on a firm foundation to really come together to know that we're interrelated and interconnected. I want to thank you all for helping me as well and letting me be a part of this second installment of the National Black Church Initiative focus on COVID-19 and other health disparities and going on in this country. Reverend Anthony Evans, I'll turn it over to you and then we'll close it out with a song.
Yeah. Well, thank you again, Kelly. Excellent job. And certainly thank our guest, Dr. Lisa Cooper, and Ms. Cassandra Smith. We are very humble of your insightful understanding of clinical trials and the need to put that back on the front burner in our community. The National Black Church Initiative will provide the leadership there, along with books like what Dr. Cooper is doing. So we are very, very humble of Why Health Disparities is Everyone's Problem. So, Kelly, take it away. Thank you again.
Well, again, God bless you all. Thank you for letting me be a part of this. And anytime that you would like to expand this conversation into the mainstream of media, I will remind you again that I'm the host of The World Tonight with my co-anchor, Niara Hawk. And we are on Monday through Friday, 5 to 7 on the Black News Channel. And certainly this is a very important topic that we need to keep front and center. I think the media has done a good job this past year. We can do more. And now that we have a Black News Channel that's devoted to, talking about the illuminated truth going on in the Black community, I would encourage each and every one of you to reach out to me anytime to focus on this and other issues affecting our community so that we all can be lifted up and thereby lift up the nation. So I leave you tonight with this afternoon with this song. I don't know which song they picked, but I sent it a couple. So thank you all. God bless you.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I'm tired, I'm weak, and the light. gracious Lord, take my hand and lead me home. Stay.